its object is the law of liberty. Lord Lindsay once said to a group of clergy, "What profits your argument for Christianity? And no one wants to hear your arguments. You ought to be witnessing. Does this thing work? Then share it with the rest of us." And so that's what I'm asking you to do, to share it. I tell you, it works. We'll find that which the whole vast world has been seeking. And it works. But you'll not know it by just hearing about it. To be convinced, you must test it and prove it. And you can prove it. Now we turn to the great book, the Bible. And you'll be the judge to what extent you've accepted the testimony of Jesus. Or will you be here night after night? That it's very important that we hear the testimony of Jesus and respond to it. So when I make the claim here, quoting Blake, that all that you behold, though it appears without, it is within, in your imagination, of which this world of mortality is but a shadow. And I mean that literally. This is not just a lovely poetical thought, beautifully expressed by Blake. He meant it literally. And so the Bible makes the statement, you'll read it in the 6th chapter of the book of John. It's really called the chapter of secession. Because in this chapter, a bold claim is repeated throughout the chapter. And at the very end, they seceded. And the statement that calls it was this: no one can come unto me unless the Father who sent me draws him. And I will raise him up at the last day. And then we are told, he asks a very simple question, and suppose you saw the Son of Man ascending into heaven. There was no response. No one believed it. And then he said, that's why I tell you that no one can come to me unless it be granted him by the Father. No one. And then he says, now the evangelist writing the story is now allegorizing. And so it's there, and Jesus knew from the first who those were who did not believe, and who it was that should betray him. Knew from the first who did not believe, and who should betray him. Now we read the story carefully, and he said, he repeats it again, no one can come unto me unless the Father who sent me draws him. Then we are told that many at this point, many of the disciples turned back, never to walk with them again. Never to go with them again. Well, who are the disciples who turned back? They couldn't go all the way. They came away, but they couldn't go all the way. Now, who then judges you? For the problem is taking place in us. We hear the testimony. We hear it on a platform, or we read it in the book, or maybe we have the experience. But to what extent can we go all the way? We are told that there's a law, the law of the identical harvest. That be not deceived, God is not mocked. For as a man sows, so shall he reap. And then we are told, and the Lord said, let the earth put forth vegetation, plants bearing seed, and fruit trees bearing fruit in which is their seed, each according to its kind. No variation, each according to its kind. Now I think the whole vast world will accept that in the vegetable world. And they will come into the animal world and accept it. That cows produce cows, and men produce, men and women produce, well, men and women. And so we can take that law in the natural world and see that it does work. Can we step beyond that boundary and take it out in the mental world? Can we now actually perform a mental act, an imaginal act, and observe the working of it, and then admit when we see the fruit that the imaginal act of the seed planted by us and the thing that we see reflecting it is we? see no man of his victory now. No man can come to me unless the Father who sent me brought them. And I raised him up at the last day. Can you go that far? Well, they couldn't go that far. They could go as far as relating an external event to an internal imaginal act, but they could not believe for one moment that encountering a total stranger in the world, and that stranger comes and plays a part in my life, that he cannot come unless my Father draws him. And I and my Father are one. I am in the Father, and the Father in me. So that no one comes into my life and plays any part in my life of what I am doing. Good, bad, or indifferent. He just can't come. Well, man isn't big enough as yet to accept that widening circle. Can't quite stretch it up that far to encompass the whole vast world, and that everything that is happening in his individual life, he is the cause of it. He can't quite relate these events, when they are touched by living beings in the world, to anything that he inwardly has ever done. He can't relate it for one moment. But I say, you be the judge. Whether you believe it or not, for example, I know everyone from the very first. Why did he know everyone from the very first? Well, who is he that knew all this? Are we not told? What person knows a man's thoughts? Except the spirit of the man which is in him. No man knows a man's thoughts except the spirit of the man which is in him. But who is the spirit? In you. I tell you, it is Jesus Christ. I have been crucified with Christ. It is not I who live, but Christ who lives in me. Read it in the second chapter, the 20th verse of Galatians. I have actually been crucified with him. And it is not I who live, but Christ who lives in me. So the Spirit in me knows, he knew from the beginning whether I believe it or not. So that I sit here this night, do I believe it? To what extent will I believe this law of liberty? Whether not a thing is happening that I didn't cause, not a thing in my world. Well, who betrayed me now? I knew the one who had betrayed me. But no one can betray me unless he has my secret, but no one. You can't betray a man unless you know the man's secret. And to know the man's secret, you'd have to be the spirit of that man. So who could betray a man but himself? So no man takes away my life. I lay down myself. The power to lift it up and the power to lay it down again. So no man takes away my life. So he knew the one who would betray and should betray him, because he is himself. He is self-betrayed. He knows the secret to the point where everything is happening in his world because he is the sole cause of all the things that he encounters, that experiences, that is the other cause. He knows it. And so he has betrayed the creator's spirit within himself. He knows what is the cause of it. He's found it in himself. His own wonderful human imagining is the Christ spirit in him that really is the cause of the phenomenon of his life. He knows that. And so now his self betrayed. He will share it with the world, but who will accept it? He will tell it to the world, and so they will themselves judge to what extent they will go with him. But when he comes to the statement that no man can come unto me, except the Father who certainly draws him, we draw the line there. Now let me share with you what has been given to me. The gentleman is here tonight, and this is his story, as given me last Tuesday night after the meeting. The scenes were all right individually. But for some reason or other, I just wasn't satisfied with the story. So Sunday morning, realizing that the story was the problem, and not my treatment of the story, I did introduce a Robert Louis Stevenson. And then I imagine how he must have felt after he had written a good story. Then I went back and put on my own shoes and tried to match that feeling, which I have imagined to be Stevenson's feeling, as he felt having produced a good story. That was the technique that he employed. He said, all this happened while I was taking my morning walk. When I came home, I began to list point by point to my wife what I thought was wrong with the story. And then, point by point, I saw someone standing behind me and counting me. And suddenly, the solution to each point came into my mind. Just as if someone was standing behind me and prompting me. And the whole thing came into my mind, point by point. Now he said, I should add that while I was gone, my wife had imagined wonderful things are happening. Wonderful things are happening. Wonderful things are happening. So I'm quite sure that your wife would understand. But when a man is at home day in and day out, a woman has to use generalizations, sweeping generalizations. So she would understand that because my wife and I spend for 24 hours a day and 7 days a week. We are in the same place. And so he, the writer, uses his home as I use my home. So, with that confession off, he said about an hour later, I was in the shower. I was presently recalling an experience of 6 years ago. Recalling this thing that happened 6 years ago. When a story was being, or it seemed to be, dictated to me in a like manner. The thing that just happened, as someone standing behind me and dictating the story of this past hour. And it seemed 6 years ago, as I recall the story, that this happened in a like manner. Some presence dictated or seemed to dictate the story. And then it hit me like a sledgehammer. For the story of 6 years ago was this, that central character in the story of 6 years ago was Eddie. Identical, done to a T. It was Eddie. And then, if you were here when we told the story of Eddie, let me now tell you the character that he conceived 6 years ago. He said he was mildly insane. Well, you know, Eddie was committed to an insane asylum for those who were mildly insane. He said the character was periodically picked up and released by the police. Well, the police picked up Eddie and read a book. Asylum wouldn't take him back. The police didn't want him, and so the police released him. He said, for plot reasons, I gave the character a limp in the right foot. The right leg. So had Eddie a limp in the right leg. He said, the people of the town, of the character, treated him in the way that the people in my neighborhood treat Eddie. The character lived in a tent outside the town. Eddie lives today in a tent up in the hills of Hollywood. The character wore the kind of clothes, the same clothing that Eddie wears. The character had a fascination with atomic fallout. In fact, he perpetrated a hoax upon the town and almost scared the daylights out of them and about to lynch him. Eddie has the most unusual fascination for atomic fallout and tells me he has a pipe. But when he wraps it with some other piece of metal, he can cause atmospheric disturbance on any part of the earth. And it disturbs him because he feels his misuse of this pipe, which he calls his space needle, is the cause of the unrest in the life on the desert, which, said the writer, is perhaps safer than where he usually keeps it under my house. And so, the same intense interest, when he said this is the amazing similarity between these two, that the feeling I have always had for the character is identical to the feeling I have for any. Now, he said, I didn't tell this story to my wife immediately. I wanted to test it. And so I began to tell her and describe to her a story of a character. And I purposely omitted the limp in the right leg, because had I said it, she would instantly have thought of Eddie. So I didn't mention that characterization. Then I omitted completely from my vocabulary the use of the words unwanted and rejected, which, by the way, in describing this character, he felt himself unwanted and rejected. But in spite of these omissions, she said to me, you were talking about Eddie. And then, said he, I was stunned that my wife, on a description of a character I conceived 6 years ago, could see in that character and not see that character. But I'm talking only of one character she knows, Eddie. So I really should sign this letter worried. For the simple reason, having written all my life, I have created some characters that I am in no hurry to meet in the flesh. So, everyone has done that. Then he goes on, and of course, I'll quickly turn to your book, The Law of the Promise, and reread the chapter. There is no fiction. And now, said he, with this off my chest, as it were, I must say something good in favor of an outside God and candles. For in my present state of mind, I think that really such a thing, an outside God, would be more comforting than to be the God creating all these things that's coming into my world. But I reflect upon the characters as a writer I have conceived and projected on the screen, characters I don't really want to meet in a hurry, not in the flesh. Then he said, I hope you'll keep this letter in a safe place. Because if I ever want proof or insanity, I will have it. You keep it in a safe place, and there I need it to prove my insanity, for there is the proof. For here, this one, this gentleman, has gone all the way, and is willing now, from his confession in this letter, to admit that the character Eddie, that seemingly came by accident after a great rainstorm, that all the clouds were rough in the neighborhood, and Eddie had no job for the day, and thumbing his way up the hill, up to where he lives in his tent, this gentleman very kindly gave him a lift, and the friendship began there. Because outside of this friendship, which he says is the same intense feeling he has for him that he had for his character, and he always had for the character, we have no social meeting point. We do not travel in the same social circle, intellectual circle, financial circle. Yet, there is a closer feeling, I'm quite sure, towards this Eddie, than he has towards written by intents of those who move in his circles. And he created Eddie. So I said that everyone, you may not recognize the character. Maybe you have a writer. And have written to the point where you can remember an actual character that you created out of the nowhere. And have it produced. And saw the production yourself. And moved almost to see the character that you remember. And then he ran into the flesh and blood character that he conceived 6 years before. So the sixth chapter of the book of John. No one can come unto me unless the Father who has sent me draws him. The last day, I will lift him up. I'll raise him up at the last day. For I'll tell this gentleman exactly how he's going to raise him up. The day will come, and the last day doesn't mean the last day of 24 hours. It means the last day of the journey from the cradle to the grave, when it is your last last time around. And you're not on the field of declarants anymore. And when that last phase comes to an individual, he will have this experience. When he least expects it, no one ever told him about it. And maybe what I tell you now, you'll forget and quickly forget. So when it happens, it will come as a very wonderful pleasant surprise. Because you have no memory that you heard it from my lips. But what? You don't know about it, you never read about it, no one told you about it. And one night, or may come through the day, but in my case, it always seems to come at the wee hours of the morning. And so, you will be suddenly twisted from within yourself. Like a corkscrew, and through your skull you will go. And you'll be clothed in the most glorious body of fire and air. It's self-luminous. You need no stars, no sun, no moon to illuminate your path. And a heavenly chorus will call your name, whatever your name is. And they will pronounce the name and say, he is risen. Not he is risen, but the name. Say your name is John. John is risen. John is risen. They'll repeat it. And then this chorus will sing out, the most glorious heavenly chorus will sing, your praise because you have been risen. And then you will come upon a sea of infinite imperfection, human imperfection. The limp or dead will be there. The blind, the half, the withered, everything you've conceived, all taking human form. And they're waiting for you, their Redeemer, to redeem them. And as you glide by, you seem to glide by, everyone will be transformed into the image of perfection. You do not raise a finger to make it so. Blind people become those of perfect sight, the deaf hear, the limp, the halt, the withered, all cease to be what they were as you pass by. And when you come to the very end, and the last one is finished, and all are perfect, then the same heavenly chorus will exult and ring out, it is finished, the last cry on the cross. And then you, for unfinished business, will return here to complete it, to turn it, maybe to leave it in a more permanent form in the form of a picture or a story, but you will tell it in a more permanent form. Then you yourself have none of experience, but that's forever as far as you are concerned, but you will tell it for the benefit of others, and scream it out as it were. Return here to complete the few remaining years, for your end is at hand. Everyone had to be raised that you were created. Everyone had to be transformed into perfection to conform to you that you were lifted up at that very moment you were perfect. And so as you walk by, you molded them in harmony with the perfection springing within you. And you do it without effort, without taking thought. You are above the conceptual mind. You're not concerned about these people. You simply walk by knowing in the depth of your soul, it is all perfect. And everyone is reshaped and molded in harmony with that perfection springing within you. So you're told, if I be lifted up from the earth, I will lift all men unto me. I will shape them and transform them. And so no man came save I called him. If I call any, there will be. And then memory served me well. I'm taking a shower. And suddenly I'm presently recalling a story of 6 years ago. And when I recall it and develop it, suddenly it dawns upon me. For I've been walking around this past 2 years in the company of one that I myself have created and I didn't recognize. Here is a man in my own world, and for 2 years he's been in my life, and been an intimate of my world, and I didn't recognize my own creation. Well, that's what the world does all day long. It draws only its own, but doesn't recognize its own creation. No man cometh unto me save I call him. For my Father and I alone. So if he can't come unless my Father draws him, he can't come unless I draw him, for I and my Father alone. And so I'm drawing every being into my world, good, bad, or indifferent. So when I think he is nothing, and he crosses my path morning, noon, and night, he is no good Where in my will can I go back to that moment of mistrust in me when I really couldn't trust myself? I couldn't. I was afraid of my own behavior if given an opportunity. If I thought I could get away with it, I might. But I may not be able to sit down and write the story. I could enact the story. I could walk to a store. And if no one really had eyes upon me, I thought they didn't, I might contemplate with pleasure an act that, if caught, would be quite embarrassing to those who love me. I might. If in the past I ever contemplated that someone's going to cross my path and come right into my world, I'm going to pay that right in my world. I'm not condemned for it. But in condemning him, I'm condemning myself because he is my very self. Bearing witness to my own creations. Bearing witness, I told a story here once, many years ago. It was a very intimate story. And I told it certainly not to bear any hate of him, but to encourage every person in this world to forgive everything in this world. Because you're the cause of the behavior of everyone you're observing in this world. And I told it in a most intimate manner because it struck home forcefully. And I was severely criticized by the audience for it, and criticized the following month by the wife of the gentleman who brought me to this town to give a series of lectures. And she said, I thought that was very, very unbecoming. And so many have criticized you for it. They've written me letters. I can tell you about many of them are letters I received that are very, very critical of what you said from the platform. I said, I didn't say for any purpose other than to show everyone that they are the cause of the misbehaviors of others that they condemn. They are the cause of it. And so, I tried to explain to her that it was not condemnation of the person. I was putting myself out of the cause of her arrest, the cause of her action. And this is the story. I was married and separated for 15 years. No divorce and no final separation, no legal separation, but separated. I was married at the age of 18, father at 19, separated at 20. And then for the next 15 years, we lived our separate lives and only saw each other when she drove me to court for non-payment of alimony. That's the only time we ever saw each other. I always came out of the court with a reduction. Always, one after the other. So, seven times before the judge, and seven times it went down this way. And finally she knew that without taking any more, there's nothing else to get. You get nothing the next time. And so that was the picture. So I told that story. All these things are happening. And one day, I knew I wanted to get married to a certain party, who is now the mother of my daughter. But I had all this entangled personal life. Not separated legally. You can't get divorced in New York City except on one grounds, the most archaic law in the world. That there's nothing but collusion goes on in the courts, divorce courts in New York City. So I was hoping it forced upon man because of this archaic law. Well, I wanted my divorce. And then she was told by a very close, intimate friend of mine that I wanted a divorce and to really leave town, get out of town. But my friend didn't want me to get a divorce and marry the girl that I eventually married. So, I thought, all right, I will now apply this law, and I stepped as though I were happily married to the girl who now bears my name. And at the end of a week, my dancing partner, I thought, was the one who had been told her to fly, and she was, came to me and told me that she had only as a brother. Just a brother. She could never marry me because it was not that feeling towards me. But that made me very happy. And then, the other one was gone now. Never to be funded again. So, the world would think. But I still stepped in the assumption that I was happily married. And one morning, the phone rang. As I answered the phone, it's the courtroom calling. This is the federal building. I said, yes. Are you Neville Goddard? Yes. Are you the public speaking post by the name of Neville? I said, yes. Well, now you've got to be in court. for next Tuesday morning at 10. Well, I was too sleepy to ask why. And so, next Tuesday morning, just a little before 10, here, the phone rings again. Are you Neville Goddard? I said, yes. And why aren't you in court? Didn't we call you last Tuesday to tell you to be in court today? Why should I be in court? What's wrong that I should be in court? I have been subpoenaed. Then he said, Miss Barbie, you're a public character, and the reporters are always in court, and you'll have to get this bit of story into the papers, and the papers today. Well, I said, well, what's wrong? They said, well, your wife happens to be on trial, and so if you would come on down, and maybe you could throw some light upon this. So I went on down. Got into the courtroom just in time to see them bring up into the dock, as it were. Three judges came in, took their position, and then someone whispered to one judge, and then the boy said, is Mr. Goddard in the courtroom? I said, I'm here. Would you take the stand? You're not swearing, not under oath, but maybe you could help us to throw a little light here. And so I took the stand, and they asked me if we were the same religious faith. They said, no, she was born a Catholic, I was born a Protestant. But that's no problem. She is not a practicing Catholic, and I'm not a practicing Protestant. So it's not that no problem at all. And then he said, well, then, could you throw some light? I said, first of all, she's 8 years my senior. And you know my age, that we must know her age. She's undoubtedly passing through some emotional disturbance. And so when a woman is passing through such things, well, they can do any irrational thing. What she's now charged with, I am quite sure she's never done it before. Even if you have the evidence to support it, I still say she's never done it before. I will swear she'll never do it again. I ask you, for my son's sake, who lived with me, that if you've got to sentence her, that for the law's sake, sentence her, but then be merciful and suspend him. He said, I've never heard a plea in this court of mine similar to that in all my years on the bench from a man who has nothing to gain by this merciful plea of his, when he really wants to divorce because we have all the evidence before us taken from your wife when she was in jail for this past week, waiting for this dead trial. He said, I'll act upon your recommendation, Mr. Goddard. I've now sentenced you to 6 months and suspended. Don't you ever come before me again. Mary met me in the lobby. He said, that was a very decent thing of you to do, Neville. Give me the papers. I said, I don't have any papers with me. Come, how would I give them to you? We wrote it together. First time in these many, many years, we were the closer one between the judge and the bench. We wrote together to my hotel, and I gave her the papers. I have not been able to serve for a number of months. Here were the papers. And we got my divorce uncontested. So I told that story to say that I caused her to do what she did. And I not assumed that I was free to marry the girl that now bears my name. She would never have done these things at all. And so she goes into a store, and the first coming of life, she picks up something that she hadn't paid for. And someone saw it. I'm sorry, it was a silly thing. But nevertheless, she did it. And that's what brought her into the city, that I could find her. And she was moved to ask me to give her the papers because I pleaded for her. And so having done all this, who actually was the culprit? I was the culprit. She came right into my will to play a certain board, to grant me my freedom. I'm speaking of the law of liberty. And so, should she be condemned for an act by the unseen author wrote for? I didn't write it out. I said, I'm writing it by her. But I determined the behavior of that body that she had to do something in order to not have to take the papers from me. And so I tell it only to show that don't condemn anyone. You and you alone are the author of the things happening in your life. And therefore, you would condemn a man, this gentleman, right into his grip. A limp in the right leg. Here comes a man with a limp in the right leg. You write everything into an imaginary character, and he isn't imaginary at all. You can't distinguish between what the world calls the imaginary and reality. You can't. This is all wrong. And so people could not go beyond a certain limit. And so you could say, well, I will assume that I am what I want to be, and things things happen in my world like this. But don't tell me now that I've actually created her in that kind of idea. And so many departed never to work with him again. Never. And so he turns now to the 12 who remain. He said, would you go also? And Peter answered, to whom would we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we believe and have come to know that you are the Holy One of God. But to whom is Peter speaking? He isn't speaking to another. Whoever is the character written in this drama as Peter came to that decision within himself. It's the most difficult thing in the world to accept. For this is the cause of cessation. They're seceding at that moment because they will not accept the fact that they are actually the cause of these things that are living and moving in their world. Some people, some limited, some main, and they are the cause of it. They will not accept it, you know, right? They left him, never to work with him again. And then Peter said, but to whom will we go? You have the words of eternal life. These are true. And now to whom will I turn? For you know we have believed, and we have come to know you are the Holy One of God. No thought, but turn back now to Matthew, and you see the answer. Who do people say that I am? Some say John the Baptist. Some say Elijah come again. Some say Jeremiah. And some say a prophet of old. Doesn't respond to that. He asks another question. But whom do you say that I am? And Peter becomes a spokesman. And Peter answers, thou art the Christ, the Son of the living God. He said, blessed are you, Simon Bar-Jonah, for flesh and blood has not told you this, but my Father who is in heaven has revealed it to you. Who is the Father here? He said, I am the Father. And you see the Father. So who but the Spirit in man is revealing? What Christ really is. No God to come again. No reincarnation. But man has Christ within him. And he's awakening. More than more and more. So the gentleman wrote the story concerning Eddie. That you know, up until now, I really wanted to wake up. And then try to wake up. But now, I'm trying definitely to go to sleep again. Although he doesn't want, but he really doesn't need it. He doesn't want what he's just discovered. This enormous responsibility to be responsible for the character that he has created. And to all work in the end, and one after the other would enter his circle and become an intimate and one that he really is very fond of. One that he created, and endowed him with all these strange things, a peculiar mental unbalance, and a limp in his right leg, and unwanted by society, and looked down on by the neighborhood, across society from society, and left him unwanted and unwashed, and, well, repellent in many ways. And all these things he does to a character and falls in love with the character. So you can see the words, Father, forgive them. They know not what they do. They're paying all these back because they're imagined that men and women are writing dramas. And the world is forever falling under the spell of imagined that men and women. No matter what the world will tell you, the world is falling under the spell of those who are awake, who are writing intensely with emotion. So today, you try it. I hope. But the judgment is yours. Don't tell me. But I hope you can go all the way. And don't tell anyone you can go all the way because the Spirit in you, he knows. Well, you can really go all the way or you turn back tonight and take only a portion of it. Or even a little portion of it, take it. So there's a law, the law of the identical office. As a man sows, so shall he reap. Regardless of what it appears to be, weeds, you'll reap it. And you'll find in the end, everything is simply bearing witness to man, what man is doing. As breaks are linked to the heath and the wild, to the thorns and the thistles of the waste. And they told me how they would be tired, and driven out, and compelled to chase. And you would not believe people well known, but Brig is telling us that the unwholesome suppressions of the normal natural urges of the animal bodies that we wear are the cause of the thorns and the thistles of the waste. The society is clamped down about all the normal natural urges of the human animal body, and these are animal bodies that we wear. And by putting a flag upon the natural urges, then comes thorns and thistles of the waste. And what Baptist would believe that? He doesn't believe that for one second. And he thinks he's going to kill them by some insecticide or some other kind of thing. And go out and burn the rings. They'll all come back. As long as man walks the earth, who can impose these restrictions on growing healthy bodies and call them moral laws. There's a thing of this world, but man, because God is the only reality, and God is man, and man is God. So man is all imagination, and God is man, and exists in us, and we in him. The eternal body of man is the imagination, and that is God himself. So I tell you, whether you be a writer, as this young man writes, and undoubtedly writes remarkably well, to earn the kind of money he earns from his own confession. And so he writes it, and luckily Peter spot him. But he lived with him for 2 years before he realized he was his own creation. But now what he did to rectify this problem of the story, you can do it. Being a writer, he took a great imaginative writer, anyone who could write, Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde. Well, you certainly have an idea in that when you take Robert Louis Stevenson. And he can put his feet into the feet and the shoes of such an imaginative writer. And then, right behind him, someone, it was Stevenson, he called in by a mood. You can tell by the mood that you wear, for you're going to meet in this world. You wear moods, and they come. And he caught the mood. He wondered, what would the mood be like? What would it be like? And who? Ask him who? He's asking, what would Stevenson feel like? How did he feel after he finished what he considered a good script, a good story? And having caught that mood, then he said, I got back in my own shoes. And then I tried to match my own feeling to what I had imagined Stevenson must have felt. And so that he got them mated. And then to agree not touching anything in this earth, it shall be established for them in this world. If two agree, when he called the one with whom he wanted to agree, he moves. And then, as though someone stood behind him and dictated the solution of every thought that he brought the point of, it all came into his mind. It would be no problem for him, for this man, a writer, to sit down and write it out. After the all solved in his mind. Then, taking his job, and feeling very happy about what had just happened, he very presently recalls and explains 6 years ago. And while he's contemplating it, it's like a sledgehammer on his head. Who would have thought he'd been walking around with his own creation for 2 years and didn't recognize him? And he didn't want to spring it on his wife. He thought, I'll test this first before I spring it on him. And so he described the character, leaving out very pertinent things like the link in the right leg and the use of the two words, unwanted, rejected, and leaving out things that were given the cue, he still could spot the character was Eddie. And so, that story you can take to heart tonight, what would it be like if you want money? Well, mention someone who has noodles on it. What would it be like to him if he really wants money? He got many habits without any thought of money. But if someone really wants it, what would it be like if after he really went over in a big way? And if you try to match your feeling to that which you imagine he must have felt when he made what he considered the big kick, match the feeling. And then just match him and see what happens. Just try it. What we're doing here is experimenting. Because this is the greatest problem in the world. As Foster said, the secret of imagining is the greatest of all problems to the solution of which everyone should aspire. First of all, infinite power is in it if you unravel it. Infinite wisdom and Again, I repeat, I hope he keeps it up. And share it with me, that I in turn may share with you these properly lovely facets of this great diamond. For if he could put his imaginary feet into imaginary shoes and feel what the great Stevenson must have felt, then he was satisfied with the story. Then take the shoes off on his own shoes, on his imagination, for he is taking his morning's walk when all this is going through his mind. And people walking by will see a man walking by and possibly ignoring, not even have a second thought, well, there might have been what's in his mind. But no one but the spirit of that man would know. Who would know for that moment that Stevenson was walking by? But while he was wearing the shoes of Stevenson, Stevenson was there. To the point that when you said it, you would not see the man that was there and his wife would see. You would see Stevenson. You mean you would? Because all things that are now behind in one another's being mingle. And so they are outside in space, outside in time. They're only as far away as you allow them to be. And your words can call them. Any being in this world. You can call anyone that's been gone for a number of centuries. Call it. That feeling that you need. Put yourself into his shoes and call it. And then, if you have a problem as he had a problem, you have the same sensation that someone is standing behind you and prompting you. So that point by point, the solution is given to you, it comes right into the head. If you believe that Brick, who died in 1827, could really solve a certain problem for you, feel the presence of Brick. Because they're not pushed out as the world would think. Say, in time, back to 1827, he certainly is not in any little grave in England. No one is there. And so they were only as far away as you let them be. So he went back and read the chapter on There Is No Fiction, and discovered he, the writer, and very humorously when he said in his letter, having written all my life, I have created such characters. I have shown you that I am in no hurry to meet them in the flesh. But it doesn't matter. The day will come, he will move up by a spiral motion when you least expect it. And without effort, walk by and redeem every one of them. Every one will be forgiven for the plotting grave here because they're created either wittingly or unwittingly. And so, I ask you to join with me. Go to the text, and don't delay with your letters. Bring them to me. Just as many as you possibly can, that I may encourage others to try it too. Because this, when you go home, read this chapter, the sixth chapter of the book of John. It really is the cessation chapter. They all departed, never to walk with him again. And only the few remain. And he turned, and they said, where will we go? You have the words of eternal life. And we have believed you. And we have come to know. It didn't come overnight. We have come to know you are the Holy One of God. For the Holy One of God is God himself. You come to know it. But you're not pointing to a man. You found a creative presence within yourself. And although the world would try to make you feel that a creative presence is a power. Speak of it as it. Don't personalize it. Oh, yes, you did. Is yourself your father, actual person. So Christ is in you as the creative power in you. You are doing it, and you are a person, therefore Christ is a person. So is your Christ a person? You always talk about Christ as the creative power. He is not only a person, he is the only person. He is the heavenly man. You're finding in yourself the heavenly man, the man that cannot die, the immortal you. And when you find him, don't let him go. Let everything else go, but don't let him go. So then Paul writes to Timothy. He said, I know whom I have believed, not what, whom. And he's speaking now of Christ, and yet he defines Christ as the power and the wisdom of God. Having defined it as power and wisdom, he personifies it, personifies it, because of himself, as we found. He found it in himself. You'll never find him on the outside. And so, to what extent this night you can go with the testimony of Christ Jesus, can you go all out and say that no man, no one, male or female, can come unto me unless my Father sent me, draws it. And I'll raise him up at the last day. Leave that section alone. That's going to happen anyway. But to what extent can you accept that testimony? That no one can come unto me unless my Father who sent me draws him. And I and my Father are one because I am in my Father and my Father is in me. Can I go that far? And then go all out that not one being in this world could cross my path that I did not call. And those who come more intimately into my circle, they're really a thing that I've been dwelling upon. You start dwelling upon the so-called tyrants of the world and traveling your mind far. You find yourself to be living in Russia. He lives right next door. Comes right in. And then you want to get rid of him. You've been creating in your mind for a certain something, and he comes right into your world. You draw them as you draw them under the panel. Now, let us go into the silence. Everything in Scripture from beginning to end is all about you. Not the garment that you're wearing, but you, the wearer of that garment. Everything from beginning to end is your real autobiography. Much of it you have not yet experienced, but it still is yours to be experienced, therefore truly an autobiography. At the moment you may read it as a biography, but don't think it is of another. It's all about you. The most insane revelation will prove itself true one day you experience it. It's all about you. When the child was brought forth and it was quickly caught up into heaven, you have that experience. The child will vanish from those who would try to destroy it. And the all destructive powers of the world are still begotten by you. All in a state of dream, when man was sung to sleep. So you were that being. I hope tonight you saw who Judas was. But some being who betrayed what the whole vast Christian world believes to be their Lord. No one could have betrayed a man unless he knew that man's secret. And no person knows a man's secret but the spirit of that man which is in him. Who is Judas? And the word Judas means the praise of Jehovah. Judas is praise. But man thinks the drama took place 2,000 years ago, and it's taking place. All hail. Said, no man takes my life. I lay down myself. If no man takes my life, then what are you craving a man for? I laid it down in every garment that moves upon the face of the earth. Unless I die, thou canst not live. But if I die, I shall rise again, and thou with me. And so he became man, that man would become God. And he did it voluntarily. You can imagine, well, that's Christ. That's the power of God. And it is personified, though a power, because you're a person, therefore it is a person. Every evil act of the world needs a man as an agent, therefore it is a man. Every noble act needs a man as an agent, therefore it is man. So it's all personified. So the scripture personifies the powers. Yeah, that's right. They are powers. They are personified. Yes, sir. The coming of that is not distant future right from this platform, but with answer. Some claim that man is constantly robbed by looking back or looking forward. He is so concerned about what he did and what he is going to do, what he formerly encountered, and what he hopes to encounter, and he omits the everlasting purpose, which is I am. So Christ defines himself as I am the way, I am the truth, I am the life, I am the bread of heaven, I am the true vine, I am the resurrection, all brethren. But man goes back and thinks of him as something past, and hope to meet him sometime in the future. And it's ever present. He only is in the present. So man is robbed by two thieves that he walks with all day long because Christ is crucified there in the present. is who I am. So my thief to my right, my thief to my right, I'm now listening to the past or the future. I'm omitting the only reality about the rest, which is the present. And only when I am ever reaches heaven. Only when I am I pulling up. So don't wait to assume that I am what I would be, because reason denies it. Ignore reason, ignore the facts of life, and dare to assume it, because all things are possible to I am. So the two things are with us morning, noon, and night. I've been wondering, or wondering if I did the right thing at that cocktail party last night. Did I say the right thing? Did I make the right impression? I've been worried all through the night, deeply beneath it. That's a thief. And now, I'm invited to one tomorrow. I wonder if my right tongue will be tied, or do I have the nice dress? Will I have time to go to the hairdresser? And all these things, I'm concerned about tomorrow. And it's only today. This now. This is I am. Well, I see my time is up. So do drop it and share with us by giving us in the written form.